Let us pray. Beloved in Christ, at this Eastertide, let it be our cure and delight to hear again the message of the angels, and in heart and mind to go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, and the babe lying in a manger. Therefore, let us read and mark in Holy Scripture the tale of the loving purposes of God from the first days of our disobedience into the glorious redemption brought us by this holy child. But first, let us pray for the needs of the whole world, for peace on earth and goodwill among all his people, for unity and brotherhood within the church he came to build, and especially in this, our diocese. Because this would rejoice his heart, let us remember in his name the poor and helpless, the cold, the hungry, the oppressed, the sick, and them that mourn, the lonely and the unloved, the aged, the little children, all those who know not the Lord Jesus, or who love him not, or who by sin have grieved his heart of love. Lastly, let us remember before God all those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore and in a greater light, that multitude which no one can number, whose hope was in the Word made flesh, and with whom in the Lord Jesus we are one forevermore. These prayers and praises let us humbly offer up to the throne of heaven in the words which Christ himself has taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
God announces in the Garden of Eden that the seed of woman shall bruise the serpent's head. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
God promises to faithful Abraham that in his seed shall the nations of the earth be blessed. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies, and by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessings for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice." Here ends the reading.
Frost, you wind, need more. Christ's birth and kingdom are foretold by Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Here ends the reading.
Peace that Christ will bring is foreshown. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
The angel Gabriel salutes the Blessed Virgin Mary. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
St. Matthew tells of the birth of Jesus. Now the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the young maiden shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. Here ends the reading.
The shepherds go to the manger. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. Here ends the reading.
The wise men are led by the star to Jesus. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. They knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
St. John unfolds the great mystery of the Incarnation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This most beautiful service has brought us to the climax of all of the characters in the story hovering around the manger. And the music has uplifted us and brought us there too. But we have not yet heard the words of how Mary and Joseph got there, which are found in the verses from the second chapter of Luke, verses 1-7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered, taxed. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver the child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Of all the Christmases in my lifetime, this Christmas, so confined by COVID, so infected with fear and isolation, with suffering and grief, of all the Christmases, this Christmas, I believe paradoxically, may offer the best possibility of experiencing and understanding what Luke wants us to know in the story he wrote about this birth. There will be no experience like when I was 5, sitting on the top stair at probably 4 o'clock in the morning because I couldn't sleep, so anxiously anticipating going downstairs and seeing what Santa had brought us. I sat there in complete stillness, barely wanting to breathe for fear that I might scare Santa away. And when I listened closely, carefully, intently, I could hear him. I could hear him sort of quietly shuffling around and bumping the furniture in order to get the space needed to leave toys for four children. There will be no 5 o'clock service, as I experienced in Jacksonville. We call the Bedlam service, with 700 adults and children crammed into the pews with cameras ready to film and video their children dressed up as characters of their choice in the Christmas story. We would hand out different outfits if they didn't bring their own in the cloister, and we would walk them through the process. There were always 6 or 7 Marys, 10 or 12 wise men, all had staffs banging each other in the head, cows, sheep, maybe a dinosaur even, a shark showed up one year, 1 or 2 screaming infants with gold stars taped to their heads as the Star of Bethlehem. And not here either. No full sanctuary overflowing with people who waited in line for it seemed like 2 weeks to get in and find a seat, and only to discover when you got in, they're sitting in my seat. We gather in this place so full, and even into the parlor, overflowing, hoping, as I understand, that you would be moved by the story, the lovely, incredibly beautiful music, and the candlelight singing to silent night, only to end with the rousing joy to the world. None of that. Instead, we are sequestered, safely distanced, masked, feeling disconnected in our apartments or our homes or our rooms or wherever we are watching, or you are watching this, with all the fear and loneliness and bedlam that goes with it, hopefully safe, while healthcare workers around the world face the bedlam in hospitals and families struggle to find work, food, and a place to live. But here's the thing. What's going on now is probably more like what it was for Mary and Joseph than the romantic Christmas vision we remember or hope for. While we don't think of it this way, Luke tells the story, and as he tells it, it was bedlam. Let's do a little deconstructing. We've been conditioned to think of this scene in this evening's passage as a cosmic moment of complete peace and quiet. That's exactly what we've been brought to. The lights are down, the last of the 9 readings. Here we are in that peace and quiet. The perfect little creche depicts everyone now standing in their right place, infant Jesus calmly sleeping in his crib, wrapped in swaddling clothes, Mary on her knees leaning over to him, Joseph standing tall, a little distant from it all, as most men are, not knowing what to do, angels hovering, shepherds watching, cattle mooing, sheep baaing, and even going next door to borrow 3 wise men from Matthew's cabinet to fill out the screen. In our perfect Christmas card image, subdued carols fill the sky. Still, still, still. He sleeps this night, so chill. What child is this who, laid to rest on Mary's lap, is sleeping? A perfect moment in time of what the world and the kingdom of God should be if we could imagine it. No. On the outside of the story, at least, there was none of this. No little town of Bethlehem still. No silent night, holy night. All is calm, all is bright. Sleep in heavenly peace. No, none of that. Bethlehem was bedlam. The town was packed with people from all over Israel, angry and resentful that a decree had gone out from the Roman Caesar that the whole world, which is what they thought was the whole world, the whole Roman world, would be registered and people would be forced to travel back to their birthplace to sign up for taxes, unfair taxes to the Roman government who ruled everything. And Mary and Joseph, too, were on their way to do just that. 90 miles from Nazareth, they traveled south by foot, according to Luke, for in Luke's gospel, there is no donkey mentioned. She is any day expecting to have a child. No physician in their right mind would have let her leave, but she did. When they arrived, there was no room left for them, so they found lodging in a cattle stall. And when Jesus was born, it was only Mary and Joseph to do the work. Can you imagine? Basically, Mary birthed Jesus herself. The fear, the hardship, the loneliness, the stress, the anxiety for this couple, it was complete bedlam. It was bedlam Jesus was born into, and Luke wants us to get this more than anything. Bedlam. If you've been keeping score, I've used the word bedlam a lot, and for good reason. The word actually comes from a London hospital that was named Bethlehem, the short version of Bethlehem, the Royal Bethlehem Hospital, built to take care of psychiatric patients, many of whom were abused and neglected. It's a heartbreaking and tragic story. It was even mentioned, I think, in the Crown series. Bethlehem in time became known as Bedlam, and the Word was born. While we have not, I hope, had to go through anything like what they did, we have had our share of what Bedlam feels like. And at the risk of reducing Mary and Joseph's sacred story to the insignificance of my own, I will tell you of a recent experience. Home during Thanksgiving, I had a large to-do list, so I found myself at Lowe's trying to find all the pieces needed to do it when I mistakenly wandered down the aisle that had kitchen faucets. I had been thinking that we needed to change our faucet. Anita had mentioned it several months before. It leaked, it sprayed when you pulled it out to spray the pans, and it was all corroded. And so I stopped and looked, and impulsively I found one I thought would work and put it in the cart and made my way home, convinced that I could put it in an hour and a half or so, in time for Anita, me to go out to dinner. She was upstairs working when I came in, and so I quietly pulled all the stuff out from under the sink, put it over to the side, got all of the tools out, put the new kitchen faucet down, looked at the directions, crawled under the sink, and began to try to unscrew the faucet that was there that I had put in the first place about 8 years ago that took me, I thought, an hour, 6 hours, with a lot of swearing and commotion. It didn't come out any easier than it went in. It took me an hour and a half. By that time, Anita had found her way into the kitchen, and she was completely surprised at what I was doing. She knew I was in trouble, but I refused to admit it. I finally got the faucet out. She helped me get the new one in, except I put the screw in wrong, so I had to take it out again and start over. Finally got it right and adjusted, and at the point when you take the little hose from the faucet and screw it in to the valve where the water valve is that turns on the hot water, I found that it was just an tad short. I pulled as far as I could, but couldn't quite get it over. So, okay, I'm just going to move the little plastic pipe with the valve on it and over to the side a little bit to get it on, and pop. Water started coming up like a geyser. Hot, steamy water. "We've got a problem," I screamed. "Oh, yeah." I crawled out from under the cabinet, ran downstairs to try to turn it off in the water heater in our little basement. That didn't work. Ran upstairs, screamed at Anita, "Do the best you can. Try to catch all the water. Get a bucket." Ran outside, knew that I was going to have to turn it off in the street. I found the key to turn the outside faucet screw. I ran to it. I pulled the concrete top off. It was heavy as heck. I looked down and all I could see, it was night, was darkness. I got my phone out, I turned the light on, and all I saw then was dirt. I couldn't see the little screw that I'm supposed to turn. And I'm also not only seeing dirt, but about 15 or 20 roaches scurrying all over the place. I had no choice. I had to get my hand and dig it in to the dirt and open it up enough to find the screw to finally turn it off. And when I did, it was like, ah. Only then I remembered, you know, I just turned off the water sprinkler. The house water is this one. So then I had to go over to that one, pull it up, same thing, dirt, roaches, dig it out, finally got it, turn the screw. Maybe that's it. And then I heard Anita, "It's off! It's off!" I slunk back into the kitchen, expecting to find 2 inches of water all over the floor, our 100-year-old heart of pine kitchen floor, which would have been a complete disaster of buckling. But luckily, the valve that I broke had also leaked over time, I didn't know, and decomposed the cheap particle board flooring around it enough so that all the water that came out just went down the hole into the crawl space in the dirt, I hoped. By then it was 7:45. All the water was off in the house. Anita was not happy and I was feeling stupid. I informed her again, no, I wasn't again, the first time I informed her that, by the way, I've got to eat dinner before 8 o'clock because I have a blood test tomorrow that I'm supposed to fast for 12 hours. "What?" she says. As she began to make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, I got on the phone and found a plumber who could make his way to our house at 2.5 times the normal rate. He showed up 1 hour and 45 minutes after that. Anita had long since gone upstairs to either go to bed or to call the Bedlam Hospital to come pick me up. By 9:30, he knocked on the door and I opened it. He was a young man about 30 with great manners who had great plumbing skills, and he fixed it, glued it all back together, made it work by 10:20. And in the meantime, we talked about his life, how he got to be a plumber. And he said, "Well, I didn't want to be a plumber. I'm glad I am now, but I wanted to be in the Army. I wanted to be a paratrooper, but on one of the jumps, I came down and hit my left leg in a weird way that jarred my shoulder so much at an old football injury, cracked the shoulder in about 4 places that they could never really put back together." He said, "Feel this." We were distant, but I touched his shoulder and he moved it and it was like, "But now that I'm a plumber," he said, "I get a chance to meet all kinds of good people that I wouldn't have in the Army." "What do you do?" "I'm a preacher." "Really? What makes you think you could be a plumber?" We had a great conversation. We had a great conversation. He shared his faith. He didn't try to convict me or convince me of his faith. He just simply shared how, after that accident, he came to experience the presence of God in a new way he'd never felt before, because he was sad and depressed and lonely, and he'd lost his sense of vocation, yet somehow God had worked his way into it. And I'm like, yeah, this is it. I didn't try to convict him or convince him in any way. I just sat and listened. He would ask questions. I would tell him I don't know all the answers. By the time it was all said and done, we bumped fists, and he walked out. And I said, you know what? In the midst of this bedlam, that was a God moment. That somehow the Spirit of God had made itself in that complete place of chaos, and something new was born in that instant. In the large scheme of things, my personal bedlam is trivial, self-imposed. But it felt really bad at the time. Yet there it was, God being born in the midst of it all. T.S. Eliot, the great poet who wrote the four quartets in the section Burnt Norton, has a line that still sticks with me, the still point of the turning world. The still point of the turning world. That micro moment of time past and time future coming together in time now. A time that is before time and beyond time. And ill in time in this still micro point. And this is what I think Luke is offering us in this story. God does God's best work in the midst of bedlam. This is where God shows up. This is what it means when we say God with us. This is why this Christmas story and those soft carols are so powerful to us now, after the fact. For they remind us, if we pause and ponder and wonder, and if we stop and are still long enough to contemplate that still point in the turning world in our own hearts and souls, if we listen carefully to the soft voice in the cacophony of chaos and squint our eyes enough to block out all the Christmas lights, we might barely hear it. We might catch a glimpse of him, the meaning of Christmas as it was meant to be, God present in the good and the bad, God with us in whatever we are going through, whatever bedlam surrounds us, God is still with us. I only wish all of you were here with us together. But it's okay, you see, because wherever we are, we now know God is with us. So wherever you are, just listen when you light your candle. Listen in the dark and listen quietly, expectantly, maybe when you can't sleep later at night, you don't get it now, but maybe then, and you might just hear him like I did when I was 5, rummaging around in your home or in your heart, doing the work of moving things around enough to find the space to leave the gifts that we will discover when the light comes in the morning. Merry Christmas. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you make us glad by the yearly festival of the birth of your only Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that we, who joyfully receive him as our Redeemer, may with sure confidence behold him when he comes to be our judge, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Can you hear it? Let us pray. May he who by his incarnation gathered into one things, earthly and heavenly, fill you with the sweetness of inward peace and goodwill, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.